Penguin Random House Canada presents Me Three by Susan Juby. Read for you by Justin Miller. For Emily. 10 Rules for Living a Lucky Life. From the author of Get Lucky, A Player's Guide to Poker, and the star of Get Lucky TV. 1. Don't take things personally. 2. Look for the upside. 3. Never show an unlucky hand. 4. Learn about people. Then learn about cards. 5. Put together a winning team. 6. You've got to answer the door when luck knocks. 7. Don't chase a losing streak. 8. If your cards keep coming up bad, change the deck. 9. Surf the waves of fortune. 10. Avoid the negative. 1. Hey, Larry. I know you're really busy right now and will get back to me when you can. That's what your housekeeper said when I called your house because you didn't answer my texts or DMs. No problem, man. I get it. Even though it's kind of weird not to talk to you for so long, I'm not taking any of it personally. That's the first rule for living a lucky life. Don't take things personally. But I thought I might write to you about how it's going here, so I don't forget anything when we finally talk again. Don't worry. I won't actually send you a whole bunch of letters. That would be weird. But I might use them for notes when my mom and my sister and I move back to Vegas and everything goes back to normal. Hey, do you think letters like this would work for our personal writing assignments? I know we're not allowed to take that course until 7th grade, but maybe this will help me get a head start. The main thing I wanted to tell you is that it's impossible to let people know you used to be cool, especially when you can't tell them who you are. You can't just walk up to them and say, "Hello there. You may not know this, but at my old school, I had friends. And some people thought I was funny. A couple of girls, such as Trelawney Johnson, even said I was handsome or whatever." Explaining former social success is not cool. It's like a catch-23, or whatever that's called. As you know better than anyone, Lair, the coolest thing about me was always my dad. And my mom says we can't mention him here. What good is having a dad who is a famous professional poker player who wrote Get Lucky, one of the best-selling poker books of all time, and who is also the star of Get Lucky TV, if you can't mention it? You know how it is since your mom is the head producer of Get Lucky TV, and we get to share in the glory together. Anyway, the point is that we're using my mom's last name until things settle down, whatever that means. Which reminds me, I'm sorry about your mom and everyone else who lost their jobs when the show got canceled. My dad says it's just temporary until everything gets figured out. As soon as that happens, everyone can go back to work, and we can come home, and things will get back to how they used to be. I just want you to know none of what they're saying is true. Missy Stevenson is not telling the truth. My dad didn't do what she said. He would never do that to someone. Especially not a celebrity guest who is also a movie star. I really hope you know that. My dad's whole job is taking famous people to high-stakes games, as if he would ever do something to one of them. You might be wondering why we just disappeared a couple of weeks ago. Maybe you're even a little mad about it. Well, we had this family meeting, and my dad explained the misunderstanding that happened at work. It was pretty bad. The meeting, I mean. No one likes family meetings. Unless they're about where to go on holiday. Even then, they're not that fun in our family, because my sister hates sunshine and joy. But this meeting was extra bad. My mom didn't speak the whole time. My dad said he had to go away for a while because of the misunderstandings and false accusations. But he promised it would all work out and that we should follow his rule number 2 for having a lucky life. Look for the upside. As you know, My dad's English accent always makes him sound like he knows what he's talking about and like you can trust him. My mom and Kate were so upset we didn't really finish our terrible family meeting, which was a relief. But right after, like the same day, my mom made me and Kate pack up our stuff and she drove us here. And my dad went to a treatment center for people who are having problems, like being addicted to drugs or gambling, which is quite sardonic, I think that's the word, seeing as he's a professional poker player and gambling is sort of his job, or it used to be. I guess in his case, he's staying there to help with how it feels to be misunderstood, for being funny and friendly, and maybe giving a few too many hugs to celebrities who aren't used to being touched, so they accuse you of taking liberties and ruin your whole life and the lives of your children. You might not even know where we are, since you aren't reading my messages. My mom and sister and I moved to my mom's cousin's house in Stony Butte, Arizona, to get away from everything for a while. We have been here for 2 weeks now, and today is the first day of sixth grade. Even though our school in Vegas, Circle Square, has its issues, such as too much talking about what color our feelings are, it's about 1,000 times better than Stony Butte Elementary, at least so far. I'm writing this on my lunch break, so maybe things will get better? I wore my Doug Stokes shirt. Remember when we got those? Anyway, I thought people might notice it, but so far nothing. Probably should have worn my Van Johnson shirt. I was going to save that t-shirt for tomorrow. Okay, well, you'll probably never read this, but even so, I hope your first day was good. I don't want to say I miss you, and Trelawney, and Emily, and Monty, the whole first name ends with a Y Circle Square gang, because that would be embarrassing. But I do sort of wish I was there. Keep it casual, Rodney. 2. Hey, Larry. Okay, so I have to tell you about the afternoon. If the first morning at Stony Butte was lame, the first afternoon was... whatever is a lot worse than lame. Here's the deal. I know you'll appreciate this. Like I said before, I wore my Doug Stokes t-shirt. Remember how when we showed up at Circle Square last year with our Doug Stokes shirts, everyone was impressed, and they wanted to hear about how he came to my house for a pool party and a barbecue, and you and your mom were there, and we got some major points for that? So I was happy when the kid who sat next to me in homeroom noticed my shirt after lunch. "Who's that?" he asked, after staring at the big picture of Doug's face. "Doug Stokes," I said. I thought he would say, "Awesome," or ask where I got it. I was ready to tell him how Doug was a nice guy, even though my dad said that for a smart guy, he's terrible at poker, and how my friend Larry and I went to a taping of his show. I hoped that would give me a chance to get the conversation going so I could implement rule number 4 for living a lucky life. Learn about people. I was relying on my Doug shirt to get things rolling. "Who's Doug Smokes?" asked the kid. "He is massive and has dark hair in a flat top brush cut. He looks like he might ride BMX or motocross or something. He looks like the kind of kid who might have a gun that his dad gave him." "Stokes," I said, "not Smokes. You don't know him? He's the star of the Doug Stokes show." "It's super funny. He makes fun of people who don't believe in science or climate change or evolution, and people who think the earth is flat, and religious people who don't understand about dinosaurs. He's hilarious." The kid narrowed his eyes, which probably wasn't easy because they already were practically closed from how angry and suspicious he was. "What did you say?" he said, his voice low. "I'm sorry?" I knew I'd messed up somewhere, but I wasn't sure where. "You're better than me at reading people. Maybe you would have known to be quiet. Unfortunately, I didn't.
Did you say religious people are dumb? I felt myself start to blink, which I do when I get stressed. I never used to blink much. That has changed since we moved to Stony Butte.
These days, I'm a blink lord.
No, I said, sounding weaselly even to myself. I never said that. I'm quoting Doug. God is no joke, and he will strike down anyone who sullies his name, said the kid. Oh. I'd heard of people like this kid, but I never met one before. I should punch you in the face, he said, for making fun of God. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to. I like God.
I said this even though I don't know anything about God because my parents messed up big time and forgot to teach me any religion.
Doug is just... That's his shtick, I guess. Making fun of people who don't, agree.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.